Good morning.
Good morning.
We welcome all of you to our worship this morning, especially our visitors who are here with us on this sixth Sunday in Lent, we also know as Palm Sunday. We'll follow the order of service printed in your worship folder. We'll begin our service this morning with our K through 4 children singing an anthem as they proceed into church. And following that, we'll join in our opening hymn. God bless your worship this morning.
Thank you.
Please stand. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you. God invites us to come into his presence and worship him with humble and penitent hearts. Therefore, let us acknowledge our sinfulness and ask him to forgive us. Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful, and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil, and failed to do what is good. For this, I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins, and trusting in my Savior, Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. God, our Heavenly Father, has been merciful to us and has given his only Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ, and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
In the peace of forgiveness, let us praise the Lord. Praise you, O God, for the great acts of love by which you have redeemed us through your Son, Jesus Christ. As he was praised by those who scattered their garments and palm branches in his path, so may we always hail him as our King and follow him with perfect confidence, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Please be seated. We'll join in singing our Psalm of the Day, Psalm 24, in the front of our hymnal.
Thank you.
invite you to follow along with our first lesson for Palm Sunday, recorded in Zechariah chapter 9, reading verses 9 and 10, where the prophet saw the day that Jesus would enter Jerusalem and our Savior fulfills that prophecy. Rejoice greatly, daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter of Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming to you. He is righteous and brings salvation. He is humble and is riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. I will cut off the chariot from Ephraim and the horse from Jerusalem. The battle bow will be taken away, and he will proclaim peace to the nations. His kingdom will extend from sea to sea, from the river to the ends of the earth. This is the word of our Lord. We're joining him 4:13. Please stand for the reading of our gospel. We read in Matthew chapter 21, verses 1 to 11. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, telling them, "Go to the village ahead of you. Immediately you will find a donkey tied there, along with her colt. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, you are to say, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will send them at once." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. "Tell the daughter of Zion, 'Look, your king comes to you, humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey.'" The disciples went and did just as Jesus commanded them. They brought the donkey and the colt, laid their outer clothing on them, and he sat on it. A very large crowd spread their outer clothing on the road. Others were cutting branches from the trees and spreading them out on the road. The crowds who went in front of him and those who followed him kept shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!" When he entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred up, asking, "Who is this?" And the crowds were saying, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." The word of the Lord. Please be seated. We invite our children to come forward for the children's message.
You can stand around and up in front here. You can sit down too if you want. I think I'll stand over here. Do you like going to parades? We have a big parade in Watertown on July 4th. Maybe you've had a flag, waved a flag with the parade on July 4th. That's what people like to do at parades. They wave a flag, they show they love their country, they support our country. That's fun to do at parades. When Jesus came into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday, they didn't wave flags, but as many of you already did this morning when you came into the sanctuary, they waved palm branches in there. We're told in the Bible that they cut the palm branches off the trees, waved them in the air. Someday, they put on the ground, and then Jesus, while he was on the donkey, he rode on top of the palm branches. That was a way to show that they really loved Jesus and they honored him. By waving the branches in the air and saying, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest." They were showing Jesus how much they loved him. They were giving him their praise and their worship on that special day long ago. Would have been neat to be there, wouldn't it, on Palm Sunday. One of Jesus' disciples, his name was John, he was allowed to see into heaven. And he saw believers in heaven living with Jesus. And you know what they were holding in their hands? Palm branches. When John saw them in heaven with Jesus, they were waving palm branches to Jesus, telling Jesus how great he is, and showing their love for Jesus because of everything he's done for us. You remember what Jesus did after he rode into Jerusalem on the donkey. Later that week, he was nailed to the cross. He suffered there for us. He took away our sins. Then after he was buried, he came back to life again. He left the tomb on Sunday. We sing praises to Jesus. We tell him how great he is because of all of his great acts on our behalf. He's rescued us from sin and the devil to live with him forever in heaven. We'll join the people in heaven too one day, waving our palm branches and giving Jesus praise and thanks and glory for everything he's done for us. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, what a day that was long ago when you rode the donkey into Jerusalem. People waved the palm branches and sang their praises to you. We thank you today too, and we sing our praises to you for all you have done to rescue us from sin and the devil and from death. We look forward to the time when we will join you in heaven and offer you our praise and our thanks forever. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you, children. You may go back to your seats. We will sing the next hymn. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. For Palm Sunday, we meditate on this lesson from God's Word, Philippians 2, 5 through 11. Indeed, let this attitude be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Though he was by nature God, he did not consider equality with God as a prize to be displayed, but he emptied himself by taking the nature of a servant. When he was born in human likeness and his appearance was like that of any other man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that the name of Jesus every knee will bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. This is the word of the Lord. Dear fellow worshipers of Christ, our Palm Sunday King. A person's attitude is always important, isn't it? We can describe different kinds of attitudes and contrasting pairs of words. Good attitude or bad attitude? A positive one or a negative one? A forward-looking attitude or one that is just stuck in the present? A forgiving attitude or a vengeful attitude? We are Christians. We trust in Christ as the Son of God and our Savior from sin, who promises us eternal life. We want to follow Jesus. We want to keep his commands. We are commanded as Christians to adopt an attitude like his. Our attitude should be the same as Christ's. What is emphasized in this part of God's word about Christ's attitude is humility. We are reminded of a grand and glorious fact about Jesus. Jesus was and still is in nature, God. Jesus Christ has all the qualities of God. He is all-knowing, present everywhere, perfect, holy, all-powerful. Every quality of God, Jesus has. Being in very nature God, Jesus the Son is equal to the Father and equal to the Spirit. We confess that fact in our creeds. Jesus is God from God, light from light, true God from true God, of one being with the Father. Jesus deserves all glory from all the angels, from every human being. All that has life and breath should give Jesus all praise and glory. Did Jesus then insist on always exercising his equality with the Father? He did not. We are told that he did not see his equality with the Father as a prize to be displayed. He did not hang on to that equality with the Father at all costs, never wanting to give it up. He had a humble attitude. How might we even start to try to relate to this attitude on the part of Jesus? Though in nature God, he did not consider equality with God as a prize to be displayed. Here are at least two feeble attempts. You have a very comfortable lifestyle. All that you could want, you have. But then you choose to leave it all behind. Or another feeble attempt at trying to relate to what Jesus did, his attitude. You have all kinds of rights and privileges that allow you to do whatever you might want to do. But you choose to give up all those rights and those privileges. That's the attitude of our Lord Jesus. He did not consider equality with God as a prize to be displayed. In keeping with that attitude of humility, Jesus then humbled himself. He demonstrated his humble attitude in some vivid and amazing ways. We are told here by the inspired writer, he emptied himself. It's a very descriptive way of telling us that Jesus chose, when he came into the earth with his humble attitude, not to make use of all of his power and his prerogatives and his rights as God. He emptied himself with his humble attitude. He was made in human likeness. There is so much here for us to ponder and to marvel over. The Lord God Almighty, through whom all things are made, entered into his creation. He came into time. He made himself nothing. Jesus said once, "Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man," talking about himself, "has no place to lay his head." He truly made himself nothing. We are told that Jesus took the nature of a servant. He said once, "The Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." That statement from Jesus takes us to the last days of Holy Week, when the Lord went to the lowest of the low. He became, he the one who is life itself, became obedient to death, even death on a cross. We can say absolutely that nobody has ever humbled himself more than Jesus Christ did. The one who is in very nature God went all the way to the depths of suffering and dying on a cross. That was about the most shameful death that anybody could experience during that time of world history. But Jesus, in very nature God, emptied himself and went to the very depths of dying on a cross. He showed his humility. He was willing to go that low. He was willing to go that low out of love for his heavenly Father, who had put together this plan for saving sinful humanity. He was willing to go that low out of love for you and me and all sinners, to pay the price in his blood that cancels the debt of our sin. That was Jesus' attitude, an attitude he put into practice by humbling himself all the way to the depths of the cross. His attitude should be our attitude. Our attitude needs work, doesn't it? We have the flesh still living inside of us, sin. The fleshly attitude is anything but humble. The flesh living inside of each of us only thinks about itself. It only cares about itself. It's never going to yield a millimeter to anybody else. It's always seeking out its own interests, its own advantage. The flesh inside of us, which forms our fleshly attitude, doesn't care at all about God. The scriptures say, God opposes those who have that kind of attitude. At the same time, the Holy Spirit has made us new through faith in Jesus. The scriptures command us, humble yourselves under God's mighty hand, and through the working of God's Spirit, we have and we do. We know our place before God. We are sinners who deserve nothing good at all from God. We admit our sins daily as we confess them together before God this morning. We humble ourselves before the Lord God Almighty, the Holy God. By the power of God's Spirit through the gospel, we trust in Christ as the one who did humble himself for each of us, who gave up his life for us to claim us as his own, who has taken away the debt of sin, who holds no guilt against us, and who now lives. We trust in Jesus by the power of God's Spirit, and by the power of that same Spirit, we have a new attitude, an attitude marked by humility. In the verses before this lesson for the sermon today, the Apostle Paul wrote, "In humility, consider others better than yourselves." That's the humble attitude which God's Spirit has put inside of us. We want to serve Christ. We want to serve one another. We need God's word constantly to shape us in that kind of attitude so that we turn away from the flesh, which only thinks about itself, and turn more and more to Jesus, adopting his attitude of humility. Attitude shows then in actions, just as it did with our Lord Jesus. The scriptures tell us, Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and so we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers. An attitude of humility in us, worked by God's Spirit, shows in a willingness to lay down our lives for each other. Now that doesn't necessarily mean in a literal way. Our Lord Jesus, with his perfect attitude of humility, very literally laid down his life for us. He went to steps in his humility that go way beyond anything we could ever do. We lay down our lives for each other by putting into practice an attitude of humility, an attitude like the Lord's. Again, in the verses before the sermon lesson, the Apostle Paul writes, "Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Each of you should look not only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others." With an attitude like the Lord's, putting that into action, we seek the good of one another. In that sense, we are to lay down our lives for each other. For a few moments, think in your own mind how you put this attitude into practice. How low are you willing to go for others? How much are you willing to give up out of love for others because Christ has so loved you? How are you putting into practice this attitude of humility in your various vocations or callings in life? In your family? On your job? In school, in our congregational life, in little things and in big things, how are you looking not only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others? Today and tomorrow and the week ahead, how will you demonstrate an attitude of humility like Jesus in deeds of humility done in love for Christ and for others? Our attitude should be the same as Christ's. And that attitude inside of us, worked by God's Spirit, will show in deeds of humility and love done for others. At the beginning of Holy Week, we also go forward to events beyond Holy Week, events in the life of our Lord Jesus. We're reminded here in these words from the Apostle what God the Father did for Jesus after he successfully completed his saving work, where he demonstrated his humble attitude to the max. The Father exalted his Son after he had humbled himself. Jesus now receives all glory and honor. He was raised from the dead by his heavenly Father. He was seated at the Father's right hand in the highest place that goes higher than any other place of honor or glory. The Father showed his perfect love for his Son. Jesus demonstrated by being exalted by the Father that he had completed all those saving tasks for you and me. And now he receives all glory and honor from the angels and from the saints in heaven. And the time will come when here on the earth, Jesus receives all the glory and honor that he deserves from all people. It is a mind-boggling picture that the Holy Writer places before us of Jesus on that last day when he appears in the clouds with power and great glory, and every knee bows before Jesus and gives him honor as the exalted Son of God. Every person who has lived, every person living now, every person who will live in the future will bow the knee before Jesus and give him honor and glory. Some willingly, some unwillingly. The Lord promises that we by grace will have a share in that glory of Christ. We haven't earned it, we haven't deserved it. By our acts of humility done with our attitude of humility, we're not gaining anything from God. Only by grace, because of Christ, will we have a share in that glory with the Lord. And that fact motivates us as we live here and show our humble attitude and humble acts of love. Perhaps sometimes you worry, well, are others going to take advantage of me? Or will I somehow lose out as I humble myself before others and serve them in love? The answer is, we're not losing out at all. Because promise to us is a share in the Lord's glory for eternity, where we will give Christ the praise and the honor that he deserves forever and ever. Our attitude should be the same as Christ's. With his humble attitude, he humbled himself and saved us. So let's serve him and let's serve one another with humble attitudes shown in humble deeds of love. Amen. Please stand. With love for Christ in our hearts, let's confess our faith in the triune God as summarized in the Nicene Creed. You'll find it printed out in the service folder. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated. We worship Christ by giving him our offerings. Please sign the friendship register, which you'll find in the blue binder at the end of your pew. Members of Trinity and members of other Wisconsin Synod Lutheran congregations are invited to receive the Lord's Supper and worship this morning. If you're going to receive a Lord's Supper, please circle your name in our friendship register.
Please stand for prayer. Lord of all good, our gifts we bring you now. Use them your holy purpose to fulfill. Tokens of love and pledges they shall be, that our whole life is offered to your will. Father, whose bounty all creation shows, Christ, by whose willing sacrifice we live, Spirit, from whom all life in fullness flows, to you, with grateful hearts, ourselves we give. Amen. Please join me in the responsive prayer of the church. Lord Jesus, you are the King of heaven and earth. We join the first Palm Sunday worshipers in praising and glorifying you for coming to the earth to save us. Though you are one with God the Father and Lord of all, you humbled yourself and became one with us. We thank you for living a life of perfect conformity to God's holy law in our place. Cause our voices to blend with those who sang your praises as you rode into Jerusalem. Lead us to confess you before others as our Lord.
Help us to proclaim the message of peace and forgiveness to all people.
Through our witness, assure others that your blood has cleansed them from sin and set them free from slavery to sin, death, and the devil. Dear Savior, as we walk with you this week to the cross and the empty tomb, keep us focused on your saving purpose for coming into the world. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We continue our worship with the Lord's Supper. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord, our God. Praise to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In love, he has blessed us with every spiritual blessing. He made his Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, but for the sins of the whole world. Now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and thanks and honor and glory forever and ever.
Thank you.
Christ, the same night as he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of all your sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
Please stand. Hear the prayer of your people, O Lord, that the lips which have praised you here may glorify you in the world, that the eyes which have seen the coming of your Son may long for his coming again, and that all who have received in his true body and blood the gift of your forgiveness may be restored to live a new and holy life through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Brothers and sisters, go in peace, live in harmony with one another, and serve the Lord with gladness. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with his favor and give you peace. Please be seated.